Welcome to KBVR News. I'm Michelle Rieke.
I'm Kameron Young.
And I'm Kevin Martinelli.
This Thursday, NASA plans to launch the Space Shuttle Discovery. This time, the weather is being watched closely. After the explosion of the Challenger in 1986, in which cold weather was a contributing factor, NASA imposed stricter weather rules and placed heaters at the key spots on the shuttles. In 1986, the shuttle lifted off at 36 degrees. The forecast for Thursday is a 70% chance of acceptable conditions with a temperature of near 44 degrees.
A Democratic House newcomer and a senior Senate Republican are expressing their views for an approval on a U.S. Code of Conduct bill that restricts the selling of weapons to other countries. Georgia Democratic Representative Cynthia McKinney calls it an international Brady bill. Under the legislation, arms sales would be denied to nations that abuse human rights, attack neighbors, or undermine international efforts to control arms. Mark Hatfield, Oregon Republican Senator, says that since the recent collapse of the Soviet Union, the U.S. has become the undisputed merchant of death. The legislation has been endorsed by the Human Rights Watch and 74 other worldwide organizations, which makes the outcome look hopeful for some.
Dick Davis, a paid FBI informer, testified today against Byron DeLay Beckwith, who is accused of murdering civil rights leader Medgar Evers in 1963. Davis claimed that Beckwith once talked of selective killings of civil rights figures. According to Beckwith, this would solve what he called the right wing's problems. Beckwith has been tried twice for Evers' killings. Both trials resulted in hung juries. Today, President Clinton presented to hospitals and governors a reform plan for America's health care system, which he claims is a system in a crisis. In two speeches today, Clinton tried to counter Republican claims that his plan would create an uncontrollable bureaucracy. He assured that his reforms would help a system already confused and buried in paperwork. Senator Republican leader Bob Dole calls such claims theatrics. However, he said that the Republican Party is all ready to work with Democrats to come up with a compromise.
Pan Am could find themselves staring at a huge court battle that very well could cost them millions. A federal court appeals decision have made open Pan Am to huge liability in the bombing of Flight 103. The decision in New York upholds jury awards for relatives of three of the victims. They became nearly $19 million richer. The jury in that case found that Pan Am had failed to prevent a terrorist bomb from being placed aboard the plane. The 1988 explosion over Lockerbie, Scotland killed 270 people. If the appeals court ruling stands, its findings will be binding on more than 200 cases pending against Pan Am. The lead lawyer for those plaintiffs says ultimately the airline could pay out hundreds of millions of dollars. Pan Am hasn't made any comment at this time. The State Department says China has made some progress on human rights, but still uses torture, arbitrary detentions, and forced confessions. In an annual report, the agency concludes that fundamental human rights provided for in the Chinese Constitution frequently are ignored in practice. President Clinton has set improvements in human rights as a condition for renewing China's most favored nation trade status in June. Today's report says that some of the other worst offenders are Iran, North Korea, Burma, Zaire, Peru, Cuba, Turkey, Egypt, and Indonesia. Secretary of State Warren Christopher says, "Overall, the world falls far short of the ideals of human freedom and dignity. So next time you get that little $18 parking ticket, don't complain too much, because if you lived in China, you may have just got beaten senseless."
The cable TV industry is taking action against violence on television. Cable executives have introduced a violence rating system, Voices Against Violence, which allows parents to know the content of different shows. The industry also plans to move ahead with the so-called blocking devices. These devices will allow parents to prevent violent shows from appearing on their screen. The White House and Congress have put pressure on the TV cable operations to get the rating systems and the blocking devices underway. A derailed freight train in North Carolina is not making things easy for travelers up and down the East Coast. Early this morning, 12 of 21 cars in the CSX train derailed, causing Amtrak and freight train delays. No injuries were reported, and the cause of the derailment has not yet been determined.
Members of Congress and California state officials are pleading for a quick approval of a federal relief package for earthquake victims. California Governor Pete Wilson calls the quake the largest natural disaster in American history. Therefore, he feels California should get the same federal help that other states have received in previous disasters. Wilson and other top California officials spoke at a Washington news conference after meeting with members of their state's congressional delegation. They're hoping to avoid any delays in passing the aid package in Congress. The Clinton administration is now asking for $9.5 billion for Southern California. The House Appropriations Committee is expected to vote on the measure today. The U.S. Coast Guard says an oil spill at Charleston Harbor near Coos Bay apparently had no impact on wildlife. The spill sent a thin sheet of oil into the environmentally sensitive South Slough and nearby Joe Nay Slough. By noon yesterday, the spill had been cleaned up by local organizations and area residents.
A Beaverton woman, Josephine Gomez, is seeking nearly $1 million from former Washington County probation officer Stephen Farr. In 1992, while Gomez was on probation for forgery and fraud, Farr threatened to jail her if she refused to have sex with him. On December 15, 1992, he was placed on administrative leave from the Washington County Corrections Department. Farr resigned 4 months later, and in 1993, he was convicted of official misconduct. Tektronix Incorporated of Beaverton, Oregon, once again has graciously contributed various instruments valued at more than $60,000 to the Mechanical Engineering Department at Oregon State University. Such instruments include plotters, function generators, and multimeters. The new laboratory was recently dedicated during a luncheon and ceremony that included several Tektronix officials, Jill Kirk, director of the Tektronix Foundation, and Clancy Calder, OSU professor of mechanical engineering, who was responsible for the lab development.
And news closer to home, former Democratic U.S. Senate candidate Harry Lonsdale has ruled out any run for governor. Lonsdale's name was among those discussed as possible candidates after Governor Roberts' surprise announcement last Friday that she was dropping her re-election bid. Real estate agents have complained bitterly about the Lane County Commission's decision to tax property sales. Now, a county official is suggesting that voters be asked whether the commissions of real estate agents should be reduced. County commissioners approved the new tax last week. It will add 0.35% to property sales, or $322 on a $92,000 transaction. The tax takes effect June 1st. Representatives of the real estate industry have opposed the tax at public hearings, and they've discussed starting a petition drive to revoke it. They argue the tax will have a negative effect on affordable housing and economic development. County Commissioner Jack Roberts has sent a letter to real estate representatives. Roberts says if county residents are going to vote on the tax, they should also vote on an ordinance that would limit real estate commissions to 4%. Roberts says the county commission wouldn't act alone to enact such an ordinance, but he says their support on the commission for placing the ordinance in the ballot in the event the real estate transfer tax is referred to the voters. The county expects the tax to raise enough money to fill a projected $2.5 million gap in its general budget for 1994-95. Without more revenue, the county might have to eliminate about 42 positions.
Biochemists at Oregon State University have made significant advances in the genetic study of cancer drugs. A crystalline form of the DNA of an anti-cancer drug and another drug used to treat psoriasis have been attained. OSU has a large core of researchers studying all aspects of the nucleic acid structure.
National Child Safety Passenger Awareness Week is set for February 13th through the 19th of this month. In response to concerns about the safety of children in automobiles, there is a new Oregon law covering the use of child safety seats. The 4 or 40 law, effective last November, requires that children up to age 4 or 40 pounds be in an approved child safety seat. So Kameron, have the Washington Redskins found a new head coach?
I hear it might be Norv Turner.
Well, we'll have the answer to that question and more when we get back.
Stay with us.
The Washington Redskins have offered their head coaching post to Norv Turner. Turner is the offensive coordinator of the Super Bowl champion Dallas Cowboys. The Skins had made no secret of the fact they wanted Turner to replace Rich Pettibone, who was fired at the end of the season. At the Pac Pacific Open, the top three seeds, Steffi Graf, Martina Navratilova, and Gabriella Sabatini, have posted opening round victories. Graf showed no sign of slowing down after last weekend's Australian Open triumph. The German needed just 43 minutes to riddle Croatian Iva Majoli in straight sets. Nice to have you back. I'm Kameron Young, and this is sports. We've had a few technical difficulties. The head of the International Ski Federation says a cap on downhill racing speeds may be needed in the wake of the death of Austrian Ulrike Meyer. Skiers now go 90 miles an hour, up from top speeds of 75 just a few years ago. Federation President Mark Hodler cites technology as one reason for the increase. The International Olympic Committee says a record 10 countries from around the world have submitted bids to hold the Winter Olympics in 2002. Salt Lake City, Utah is believed to have the inside track. Three members of the Chicago White Sox 1993 opening day roster have been given new contracts. Third baseman Robin Ventura has agreed to the Chicago White Sox four-year deal worth nearly $21 million. He hit 22 homers and one gold glove for last year's AL West champions. Ventura's former teammate, Bo Jackson, is heading west after agreeing to the California Angels' one-year offer. Jackson can make between $1 and $2 million this season, but will get $475,000 if the Angels cut him loose before opening day. And Seattle will be the next stop for reliever Bobby Thigpen. The Mariners signed him to a minor league contract. Ventura soon will know if he's playing with Michael Jordan. Manager Gene Lamont thinks Jordan has made improvements but hopes his presence won't be a distraction at spring training. Chicago GM Ron Shuler will decide Jordan's baseball fate in about a week. Lefty pitcher Kent Merker has avoided arbitration and re-signed with the Atlanta Braves. Merker posted a 2.86 ERA in 43 games with the Braves last year. A season-ending injury to starter Donovan Osborne has prompted the St. Louis Cardinals to sign veteran hurler Rick Sutcliffe to a minor league contract. Sutcliffe was off to an 8-2 start before finishing 10-10 with Baltimore last season. The face of college football could change even more if the SEC and the Big East make a TV deal with CBS. The two leagues cover 60% of the country, and an agreement would strike a blow to college football association and its arrangement with all major conferences except the Pac-10 and Big Ten. Locally, Tonya Harding's ex-husband, Jeff Galluli, has pleaded guilty to racketeering in exchange for his testimony against the, as of now, Olympic-bound figure skater. The plea, struck in the plea bargain, stems from the attack on skater Nancy Kerrigan 4 weeks ago. Galluli is expected to receive 2 years in prison and a $100,000 fine from Judge Donald Longer in Portland, Oregon. Sentencing is set for April 1st. Harding does have some strong local support from Philip Knight, the founder and chief executive of Nike. Knight has donated $25,000 to Harding's defense. And if you're going to be around this Thursday night, keep an eye open for flashy guard Jason Kidd and the Cal Bears. They'll be here to play hoops against the Beavers. Tickets are currently sold out, but if you get the chance, that should be one hell of a game.
Let's hope the Beavers have better luck this week than they did last weekend, as they were pretty much tooled down there in Arizona.
It's going to be a packed one.
I'm voting for the Beavs.
Stay with us. We'll be right back with the weather. Welcome back.
So, Chuck, I'm nursing a pretty nasty cold over here. What do you say? We got some warmer temperatures on the way, or am I going to...
It's going to stay kind of in the 50s. We're going to have lows in the morning around 24 to 30. It's going to be kind of cold when you get up, but you'll have about 2, 3, 4 days to nurse back that cold to health. We have high pressure that's going to nestle in over Oregon for the next few days. Right around Sunday, we should have a trough of low pressure coming in. Could spread some precipitation. It's a little too early to tell right now, so let's just go outside and look at our current conditions. Right now outside, it is clear. We've got a temperature of 32 degrees. That's at freezing. The barometric pressure is 30.28 and rising. The humidity is 82%. Our wind speed is 5 miles an hour. The direction is out of the northwest, and the freezing level over Corvallis is 7,300 feet. Looking at what today was like, we had a high temperature of 50. The record high was 64 in 1971. We had a low temperature this morning of 24. Our record was -1 in 1950. The sunrise tomorrow morning will be 7:30 a.m. The sun will set tomorrow evening at 5:24 p.m. And today's precipitation, the 24-hour total, nada. Looking at our forecast list, we've got the Oregon coastal forecast tonight, fair with light winds from the east. Lows will be 30 to 35. Wednesday, we have patchy morning fog, then sunny. Highs tomorrow will be 50 to 55 with a northeast wind up to about 10 miles an hour. Thursday, we'll have patchy morning fog again, then sunny, with Thursday's highs at the coast 50 to 55. The Cascade Mountain forecast looks like tonight fair, freezing level about 7,500 feet. The minimum pass temps will be around 20 degrees. The winds will be east 5 to 15 miles an hour. Wednesday looks like sunny. Free air freezing level 7,500 feet again, with afternoon pass temps up around 40 to 45 degrees. The winds will be out of the east 5 to 15 miles an hour. Thursday looks sunny with the free air freezing level around 7,000 feet. They've got afternoon pass temps on Thursday 40 to 45 degrees. And looking at the Corvallis area forecast tonight, clear and dark with fog forming later. Lows will be around 25 degrees. Wednesday will be a bit lighter in the morning, then foggy, and then sunny. Highs will be about 45 to 50 with light easterly winds tomorrow. Thursday looks sunny after morning fog again. Highs in the mid to upper 40s. Like I said, looking down the line, we've got maybe some rain Sunday. If not, we won't sweat too much about it.
Well, that's pretty decent news, I guess. Hopefully I'll be feeling a little better here in the days to come.
At least we're feeling better than the folks down in Texas, where Houston, actually, down there along the Gulf Coast, has gotten a little bit of sleet and snow. Quite unusual for that part of the country.
Stay with us. We'll be right back with entertainment.
Hi, welcome back to KBVR.
So who's in the spotlight this week?
Well, I'll tell you, Michelle. Hi, everyone. This is James Dixon with Entertainment. Robin Williams has done it again. It's tough to keep a good man, woman down. Mrs. Doubtfire was back on the top of the box office 10 weeks after being released. Twice now, new movies have replaced Mrs. Doubtfire in the top spot. Each time, the comedy has bounced back. Early figures show Philadelphia slipping second after 2 weeks on top. Grumpy Old Man is third, Blink is fourth, and Intersection is fifth. A new music video channel has given MTV a run for its money. Warner Music, EMI, Polygram, and Sony are joining together to create a video music channel. The channel will air music videos 24 hours a day, just like MTV and VHF one. The TV Hour advertiser-supported channel is expected to be up and running in the fall. MTV has had a virtual monopoly on music video channel business, but record industry executives have wanted a competing service to ensure that their videos were played. This sounds like it will ensure variety in the music video industry to me. Martin as the greatest. Martin Lawrence says he expects that someday he'll be as big a name as in comedy as Eddie Murphy. The star of the Fox TV series, Martin, says, when it comes to making a successful transition from TV to movies, I know I can do it. Lawrence tells Entertainment Weekly, Murphy ain't the only one who can be a success in both mediums. He also tells the magazine he's thinking seriously about changing networks. He says some of the other Fox shows featuring black stars have stolen his catchphrases and storylines, and that he has been dissed by Fox officials. Dave Letterman. Letterman brings his top 10 reasons for Tish. David Letterman honors the CBS chairman Larry Tisch by listing the reasons he likes working for Larry Tisch. Among the items on the list, Tisch would be bashed by Ted Koppel would be bashed, rather, on the knee with a metal pipe, if asked by Letterman. Tisch would pay his salary instead of bidding for NFL football. And for the number one reason why, Letterman likes working for Tisch. He promised to fix him up with Angela Lansbury. Oh boy. The cable TV industry announced today that it will start rating its programs for violence. Most people responding to a survey by a corporation of public television thinks TV is too violent. They also think that too much sex and bad language are shown on the tube. The news comes at the start of the February sweeps, when TV usually gets even more violent and sexual. The rating system will be in place in 6 to 9 months. Congressman Edward Markey says, this is the dawning of a new era. What era, I don't know. Let's see. LaToya Jackson is giving away her brother's beauty secrets. LaToya says her brother Michael Jackson uses a cream to lighten his skin. Jackson tells Geraldo that Michael had a doctor prescribe the medicine for him. LaToya says Michael has always been unhappy with the way he looks. She says that he's confused and mixed up in that way. Michael said that he has a disease which makes his skin blotchy. Jackson interviews airs Thursday on Geraldo. Now to country news. Gun control is becoming a problem in country music these days. Reba McEntire is offering trade for guns for concert tickets. A Tulsa, Oklahoma palm shop owner doesn't like Reba's offer, so he's offering to give discounts on guns to anyone who brings in McEntire's albums or concert tickets. Buck Dixon says he's a fan of Reba's, but he says she's misinformed. He says that we don't have a gun problem, but a criminal problem. Dixon says that only one person has brought in an album since he started the offer last Friday. Wow, that's interesting. You all remember Nipsey Russell and his famous poems. This is the one that gave him his big break on TV. It goes a little something like this. If you want to get even with your low-down friends who treated you the rotten to the core, give a party, serve nothing but beer, and lock the bathroom door. Russell says the key to good poetry is to keep it short, 8 to 10 seconds, so people will hear it. Russell can now be seen in the movie version of Car 54, Where Are You? In more local news, in local entertainment, an exhibit of paintings by Portland artist John Dukart go on display at Oregon State's LaSalle Stewart Center. The exhibit entitled Old and New Dreams includes a variety of paintings by Dukart, whose one-person shows have been displayed throughout Oregon. The exhibit begins February 7th and continues through March 2nd.
So here we've got LaToya Jackson, we've got an artist coming down from Portland, and I also hear that Wayne Cotter is coming.
Well, I heard that too. He might be in sometime around Friday.
Well, that's the news tonight. Thanks for joining. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night.